Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. I'm really enjoying my research and preparation for the Kosher Riverboat Cruise on the Seine this year, where there are going to be three main attractions. First of all, there's the natural beauty of the Seine River and the countryside of that part of France. Also, the 1,000 years of Jewish history that goes way back in that region. And finally, of course, special emphasis on the history of Jews in the armed forces of several countries. We're going to emphasize in particular World War I and II, and today I'd like to speak to you a little bit about Jews involved in D-Day. But let's start by having a quick look at the route that we're going to be following. Here's where we'll be beginning, at Paris, of course, and you can see the Seine River flows sort of to the northwest into the English Channel and ends up at Le Havre and Honfleur. And we're also going to be looking at the city of Rouen, which has a really fascinating a Jewish community that goes all the way back to the 11th century. In fact, in the 12th century, they had a local leader there with such importance that some Christian texts refer to the local Jewish leader as the King of the Jews. Here is a modern picture of the medieval Rue des Juifs or the Road of the Jews that exists in Rouen today. It was also the site of some fascinating Portuguese and Spanish refugees from the Inquisition, including João Pinto Delgado, who in the 17th century wrote a lot of really interesting polemics to defend the Jews who had returned to their Jewish identity after fleeing from the Iberian Peninsula. But let's focus today on D-Day, because some really interesting things associated with Jews and their military service related to this event. D-Day is, of course, Tuesday, June 6th, 1944. It is a day that marks the major Allied landings at Normandy in the huge step forward in the fight against Nazism in World War II. It was also known as Operation Neptune. It represented the largest seaborne invasion in history, with 24,000 paratroopers landing in advance to prepare the region as best as possible for the landing of 7,000 sea vessels, and nearly 200,000 naval personnel participated in total. About a quarter of those, by the way, were American. There were tremendous losses on both sides, the Allies and the Germans, about 20,000 casualties. Among the Allies, 4,000 of those casualties were actually soldiers who were killed in this very, very difficult military assault. Here you can see a map that shows the sites of the landing. The Seine River flows just to the east of the major landing sites, including Omaha Beach, where we'll be spending time looking at the region and a remarkable museum that's located there. It was an incredibly punishing and difficult landing. The Germans were well prepared for it, and they knew that it was going to be coming eventually, so they had reinforced the region, and there was a tremendous amount of difficulty and effort imposed in trying to make the landings at several beaches. Now, let us understand how Jews related in particular to this war and especially to D-Day. Jews, of course, coming from America, had a unique perspective on the war because they realized already by 1942, reports were circulating of the concentration camps, the death camps, and the horrible persecution that the Nazis were meting out on Jews. So Jews had a special sense of responsibility with regards beating back Nazism, and they realized that if they were to be captured, it would be considerably more dangerous for them than regular American POWs. And so you see Jewish efforts in several different regions of activity. In the arts, for example, Jews like Irving Berlin, who was a very well-regarded composer of popular music in the first half of the 20th century, he devoted his talents to writing what has become a major anthem for the American people, God Bless America. And in the lyrics to that song, Berlin specifically alludes to the war in Europe that is on the horizon in 1938 when it was first broadcast. The lyrics include, "While the storm clouds gather far across the sea," right? 1938, this is the era of Kristallnacht, of the Sudetenland crisis, and so on. "Let us swear allegiance to a land that's free. Let us all be grateful for a land so fair as we raise our voices in solemn prayer. God bless America, land that I love." Understood in this context from a Jew who had fled persecution in the former Russian Empire, coming to these shores and achieving fame and fortune by dint of his talent, you know, you can really understand how much he really did attach himself to America. And this kind of anthem has a tremendous impact on the larger population. Now, of course, in terms of the actual war effort, perhaps the first place we should start is Jews active in intelligence. Before the invasion, there were about 200 Jewish codebreakers working at Bletchley Park in England, which was the headquarters for deciphering Nazi communications. This is the site where Alan Turing worked and others. It was really an important place for the intelligence activity behind the war. Among the Jews who were active at Bletchley Park was Max Neumann, who was a British-born child of Polish Jewish refugees, somewhat like Berlin somewhat earlier. He was a chess prodigy, a math major. These were characteristics that he shared with many of the other Jews there at Bletchley Park. He headed a department that was casually called the Neumannry, that called for the design of the world's first programmable electronic digital computer, the Colossus, that was instrumental in determining what were the German war plans. Also in the preparation for D-Day, you have people like Fred Balcom, shown here in this photograph, fourth from the left on the top row, who flew meteorological flights at 20,000 feet to determine the best weather conditions to allow the invasion to happen. He actually was responsible for delaying the invasion by 2 days to ensure that there was the best possible conditions without an undue delay. Turning to the landings themselves, so looking at the overall participation of Jews in the armed forces, there are about 550,000 American Jews who served in the U.S. armed forces during World War II. 36,000 of them were decorated, 24,000 of them were wounded, and 10,500 were killed in action. About 40% of all Jewish physicians served in the military, a remarkable number. In the landing at D-Day, about 4.2% of the soldiers making that assault were of Jewish origin. And that is, like all these other numbers, quite disproportionate because at the time, Jews made up only about 3.6% of the population. Let me look at a few of them because they're really quite fascinating. Let's look first at Lieutenant Robert Halperin, who was the child of a Ukrainian Jewish immigrant named Aaron. And I think this combination of Ukrainian and Jewish and heroism is something that we're seeing in our own day as well. He was a part of Assault Force U, which was one of the first units that made their way ashore to mark the landing sites so that later boats could safely hit the shore, avoiding both attack from the Germans and friendly fire from the Allies. Here's a quote from a contemporary war correspondent named William H. Stoneman that Halperin was involved in an intricate job calling for as much brain as courage and barrels of both. He is certainly making a hero of himself again this morning on D-Day, doing a job on which the success of our assault depends, and which not one man in 1,000 would like to have. For his efforts there, he received the Bronze Star. He was specifically cited for bravery in saving several soldiers from drowning. He went on to receive the Silver Star and another kind of medal, an Olympic medal for sailing for Team USA in 1960. Another Jew among the first to arrive on the beaches of Normandy was Abraham Condiotti. His boat hit the shore within 60 seconds of each hour. He was possibly the first of all American soldiers and maybe even of all Allied sources to actually attack the beach. He was 22 years old at the time, a Sephardic Jew from Brooklyn. The Jewish Telegraphic Agency reported at the time that when his parents were told that their son was involved in the invasion, they went straight to synagogue and they engaged in nearly 4 hours of prayer. I think as a parent, I probably would have done something like that too. On that same boat was Captain Leonard T. Schroeder, a 25-year-old from a Baltimore neighborhood. He was featured in a French magazine in 1994 describing the heroes of Normandy, and he said at that time that, "Today I realize that to be the first man ashore is an immense honor, yet I do not merit it more than anyone else. Five of my men died down there at Normandy. They alone are the heroes." I hope this video gives you a sense of the importance of the Jewish effort behind D-Day and of those hallowed beaches that absorbed the blood of so many soldiers who went on to the fight, the great fight against Nazism in World War II. If you are able to join us on this cruise, where we'll be looking at the beautiful scenery of the Seine River, the thousand-year history of Jews in the region, and specifically focusing on the history of Jews in the armed forces, I would love to meet you in person and spend some time with you in this wonderful experience. Thank you very much for watching.